As I say, thank you very much. It's a great privilege to be kicking off the session today, talking about the art of archaeological placemaking. What I'm going to do in the next 20 minutes is just run through some recent examples of placemaking from London. It's very good to hear Tim saying that archaeology and heritage is very important in Kilkenny. You can see so much of it, and it is amazing. I've never been here before. Absolutely an amazing place. Unfortunately, in London, or the part of London where I've worked for the last 20 years or so, is the City of London. And whilst we have fantastic archaeology, there's not a lot to see. It's all been churned over, and you know, obviously there's a lot of redevelopment always going on. So placemaking is very, very important for us. What I'm going to do is run through a few examples. One main example this morning, which I think is an unusual example of placemaking, but it has a number of factors which I think contribute to the success of these sorts of projects. And then if I manage the time correctly, I've got a few slides at the end just to show you examples of other projects at a very different scale and budget. So this is what I'm going to talk about mainly. It's London Mithraeum Bloomberg Space. It's what's been called a new cultural hub in the heart of the City of London. And perhaps unusually, it's located within the basement of an office building. It's the new European headquarters of Bloomberg, who are a financial and sort of news and information company. Unusually, perhaps they finance and run and operate this new cultural hub. And it's based around and centred around what you can see in the picture, is the twice relocated and reconstructed remains of a 3rd century Roman temple that was originally found on the site in 1954. It's quite an unusual and rather sort of esoteric project. Our role at MOLA was to do the archaeological work that was required for the development of this site, but we were also consultants for the second reconstruction of this temple, and we provided the sort of curatorial content and advice for the display. It's been tremendously popular. It's nearly been open for a year. It opened on November the 14th last year. There have been over 100,000 visitors since opening. I don't know what else Charlie W. does, but he probably should get out a bit more. I mean, it's a very good display, but I think there are better days you can have. Just to give you a bit of information about it, it's free. It's open to the public 6 days of the week. It's not open on Monday, so if you want to come and see it, don't try it on Monday. Between normal sort of hours, 10 to 6. It's actually quite a small space. It's on three levels. The maximum capacity is 60 people, and a typical visit takes about 45 minutes. But it's very important to the City of London. As I say, London is a Roman city. It was founded by the Romans in about 48 AD. But you see almost nothing of it. There are a few sites. There's an amphitheatre, a bit of amphitheatre you can see, and there's bits of the city wall you can see. And by having a new attraction, it's actually sort of added to the critical mass of Roman attractions, and this in itself is stimulating new tours and new tourist interest. And we think about probably 70% of those 100,000 visitors are coming into the city specifically to see the Mithraeum. And obviously the city is not a economically deprived area, but nevertheless there are restaurants, businesses that are benefiting from those people coming in. So what are some of the success factors, and why is it so sort of compelling, or why has it been so compelling? Well, part of it is it was a pretty amazing discovery. It's an amazing archaeological find. It was one of the most important archaeological discoveries in the City of London in the 20th century. This is where I have to be very, very careful and ration myself, because it's a great story, and I could easily take up my full 20 minutes on it. Discovered purely by chance on a bomb site by a group of archaeologists in 1952. They didn't realise what it was until they expanded the dig and had a big dig in the summer of 1954. It's one of these classic things. They didn't know what it was, thought it might be a temple, possibly even the first church in London. And then on the last day of the excavation, pretty much the last hour, the head of the god Mithras was pulled out of the hole, apparently by a workman, which is a bit embarrassing for an archaeologist, and voila, it was recognised that this was a Mithraeum. That would have been the end of the story if it hadn't been the fact that there was a photographer there, a press photographer. A little article appeared in the Sunday Times which led to a chain reaction of events where the Prime Minister then, Winston Churchill, got involved. He pretty much stopped the bulldozers removing the temple, and a two-week extension was granted to the excavation. During those 2 weeks, a whole load more amazing marble sculptures were found. They're the finest Roman sculptures ever found in Britain, now on display in the Museum of London, and they probably would have been smashed to pieces if that hadn't happened. But the other really interesting thing about it was that the public were allowed to visit for those 2 weeks of the extension. And it was a real phenomenon. The archaeologists put out a few signs and expected a couple of hundred people to come. And on the first day, 30,000 people queued up to see the excavation. It caused a public order problem. The police had to be called. And then this was repeated every day for 2 weeks. And it was a phenomenal sort of amount of interest. And before I go on and say what happened to the temple, I'll just say what Bloomberg did one very, very good thing, which I think is, again, part of the sort of success factors. They were very interested in what people thought of it, and they wanted to share the excitement of this discovery or the story, and wanted to be involved in it themselves. So they commissioned an oral history project, and we went out on the radio, Radio 4, and said, you know, did you queue up? Were you one of those thousands of people? The response was amazing. We had hundreds of people get in touch. We got hundreds of testimonies and recorded some oral histories, which we will be uploading on Bloomberg's website quite soon. What was really powerful, two things, was just the sheer sort of emotional importance of seeing the archaeological remains at that moment in time in London, when a third of the area of the City of London was still bomb sites. It had been really badly destroyed. And people were sort of, what they told us was they were almost reassured by the evidence of the continuity of the city. And also, we didn't realise at the time, but this turned out to be a sort of an unplanned piece of research into the long-term effects of seeing archaeology on your life. Because we were talking to people 60 years after they'd seen these remains. And what was really profound was how much it had changed their lives. People went on holidays to different places to see Roman remains. They'd actually taken some souvenirs from the site, or they'd been given them by the archaeologists. They'd had them on their bookshelves or whatever and told stories to their children about it, and their children had become archaeologists. It was amazing. We'd done a little graph of tracing archaeologists through the generations. One poor woman even got in touch to say that her mother had been pregnant when she queued up, and when she was born, she was christened Mithra, so that was a bit unfortunate. You can imagine she wasn't so happy about that. Anyway, to rattle on, all this interest and pressure at the time led to a lot of debates about what should happen to this temple. Should it be preserved in situ? Should it be swept away? Probably not surprisingly, the government and the City of London at the time said, well, it has to go. We can't afford to redesign buildings, and we can't possibly set the precedent when there are so many sort of British cities that needed rebuilding. So it was said it was going to be swept away, but then the site owners, who were Legal and General, did their own bit of placemaking. They said, OK, we'll dismantle this structure, put it into storage, and rebuild it somewhere else on our site when we've nearly finished the building, which is what happened. So it was moved, it wasn't moved, it was dismantled, then moved around lots of times, some of the stone was nicked, and then it ended up on about 100 metres from its original location, and you can see it in the sort of bottom of this picture. It was good that it was done, but it was not done well. And the City of London, as the local planning authority, always had the thought that if something was going to, if the building, you can see there, which is Bucklersbury House, was ever going to be redeveloped, something better should happen. And so in 2004, the site owners, Legal and General, started thinking about redevelopment, and the city responded with a design brief. And I think this is a really crucial success factor in it, that the local authority actually stepped in. There was no statutory protection for this temple reconstruction at the time, but they said, yes, we want something better to happen, and put these, you know, quite interesting clauses in. We want you to salvage the Roman material, essentially put the temple back where it was originally found, as if a different decision had been made in 1954. And then I put in bold at the bottom a very unusual clause, which was provide an evocation of a Mithraeum as it might have been used. That was a fantastic, and I often say to local authority planning archaeologists, you don't really always appreciate the importance or the value that's put on a few words. We're always asking, can we have in a condition something that says a programme of public engagement, and then people are happy to provide that programme of public engagement. Here, an evocation of a Mithraeum, as it might have been used, opened up the doors for the designers to be creative and to actually go for something which is more experiential rather than a sort of just a display with panels. But it's also highly risky. I won't go into a talk about what Mithraism is, but it's a secretive all-male cult. It almost certainly involved naked initiation rituals and some probably fairly scary and sort of things going on. Somebody described it to me as like an American university sort of frat club, or of course possibly the Masons. So it was a bit risky. Fortunately, the site was acquired in 2010 by Bloomberg, and they are a very, very responsible client to work with, and very thoughtful and very, very conscious of space. And so they wanted to do something that would be tasteful and appropriate for where they were. This is a CGI image of the building that has actually been built. And it recently won the ROBA, Royal Institute for British Architects, Sterling Prize for the best building of 2018, which is quite unusual because they don't normally go for big commercial office buildings. It's built of stone. It's the largest stone building built in London since St Paul's Cathedral. And it started right at the start of the design with some placemaking of reinstating a Roman road. That sort of slash through the middle is quite an important Roman and medieval road that ran through the city, which was lost in the 1950s and 60s development. So having a good client who cares about where they are is also very important. But having a collaborative design team was also really, really a sort of critical success factor. And I'm not going to go through what all of these people did, but the really crucial person for us within the team was the consulting curator, who was somebody who had great judgment, but also power and direct contact with the client, and was able to make decisions quickly. And that was tremendously helpful. What was also very helpful is that she was also responsible for the art commissions for the building. And what was very nice, there was a sort of interplay, really, between the artists and the archaeology and the history. So the art that's within the building references the lost Walbrook River, which once ran through the site. So there's a Oliver Eliasson piece, which is a sort of shimmering sort of piece of metal, which references the Walbrook. And Cristina Iglesias, a Spanish artist, did these pools outside, which again reference the Walbrook. So that sort of art, a non-literal approach in some ways to placemaking, ran through the whole scheme. And the exhibition designers who were chosen to provide the interpretation also took this on board. Not that much is known about Mithraism. It was a secret cult. We don't know. There's no liturgy of saying what happened in it. And also, we only had the evidence of the remains of the temple to about, you know, sort of 1.5 metres height in the original discovery. But the exhibition designers took this as made a virtue out of a necessity of not having that information, and wanted to make the space all about people trying to connect with the past or have a sense of connection with the past and using their imagination. So they also employed an artist on their team, a light artist called Matthew Schreiber, and they came up with this idea of creating a sort of ritual and an interpretation and a sense of the superstructure of the building using walls of light which would be projected through a fine mist to give it a sense of sort of solidity, and that would be animated with various sounds and to go with it. So this again is a computer-generated image. The practicality of doing this in a big space is actually quite one another thing. And we spent most of the summer of 2016 in a full-scale mock-up space trying to make smoke and mirrors and mist and light work. But thankfully, we got there. There was also the big job of actually trying to take apart the 1960s reconstruction, which had been put together with very hard cement mortar, sort out what was Roman, and actually do the faithful reconstruction, which is what you can see here, nearing completion. And I say another success factor in all of this, as well as having all this creativity and an artistic approach, is insisting on high quality craft skills, which Bloomberg absolutely did. So that's it in 2016, nearing completion, and that's as it was in 1954. It's a very sort of careful and faithful reconstruction. Now, I mentioned it's on three levels. The new reconstruction is exactly contemporary Roman ground level. It has another space next to it, which is called the sort of space up, which we call the mezzanine space, and a ground floor space. The mezzanine space is where you find out about who is Mithras. You find out just enough information to enable you to understand what's going on in the experiential space. And then a very simple idea that's been done before is when you come down the stairs or come down the lift, we sort of have etched and scratched into the stone the actual levels of contemporary Roman ground, or contemporary ground level, this is post-Roman, as you go down through time. And on the ground floor, we displayed some of the 14,000 individual artefacts that were found during our work, but in a case which is also sort of half art and half sort of museum case. There are no captions in it. You interpret it through a digital display, which you can actually access through that case.londonmithraeum.com. And then a really wonderful part of it, again, this interplay between art and archaeology, was the ground floor space was originally going to be a museum exhibition space, but Bloomberg and the City of London agreed that it could actually be a contemporary gallery space that would be, Bloomberg would commission new artists every 6 months to produce a piece of work which responds to the archaeology and heritage of the site. And this first commission, which is gone now, there's a second one in place, but this first one was by the Irish artist Isabel Nolan. It's absolutely fantastic tapestry. She took the original 1950s excavation drawings and literally sort of blew them apart and expanded them and made it into an amazing, amazing piece. And there's a lot more I could say about that, but I haven't got time. So the success factors, as well as having a fantastic site to start with, it was a very sort of committed and supportive local authority, a very engaged client, an integrated design team, insisting on creativity and high quality, and a commitment to audience through access, participation, celebration, and the space is used for schools and all sorts of groups now. The one thing I haven't mentioned here is, of course, is money. This was a very well-resourced project, and that's why it makes a huge difference. But I just quickly want to run through a few other examples which still have some of these other, what I think are success factors, but on a very, very different scale. So Altab Alley Park in Whitechapel was a very run-down park. It was quite a sort of hostile space to go in. And in 2011, so it's not that new, the local authority Tower Hamlets wanted to improve it, and they appointed a firm of really quite sort of creative and radical architects called Muff, and they came in and started doing research. There was some archaeological work required in order to understand what the history of the park was and what was left of the archaeology. We should say it's the site of the original White Chapel, which gives White Chapel its name. And they opened up the archaeological works to the public. We actually did the evaluation. Members of the public could drop in and have a go at archaeology during the evaluation. And the architects also were very interested in the archaeologists' fetishizing of artifacts. So we had an artifact exchange where members of the public, if they dropped off an artifact of their own and wrote something about it on a little label, they got a cupcake in return. And on the table in front, there were some of the artifacts with really, really powerful little micro stories in them, which I haven't got time to go in here, but it was a really powerful event which symbolized and said something new is happening in this place. Another quick example, if I'm still all right, is London Wall City Place. It's the newest example of placemaking in the City of London. And it's a very sort of small example of something rather similar to your Abbey Quarter, actually, thinking about it. There's a little bit of medieval tower, amazing survival in the City of London when, as I say, most of the historic remains were destroyed during either the Fire of London or the Blitz. And it's a 13th century medieval tower. It was, shall we say, badly served in the 1960s in terms of where it's presented in the sort of urban landscape. There's a high walk sort of clipping over it. The pavement in front of it is so narrow that if you can't actually walk, you couldn't walk along it. This is London Wall in front of us. Uncharacteristically, this photo has no cars on it, but it's normally quite a busy road. And there were all sorts of unsatisfactory things about it. the big building which surrounded it was redeveloped a few years ago, and it was recognised that there was an opportunity if the bulk of the building could be, the new development could be moved to the either side of the site, this would actually open up a space, make the project viable for the developers, but open up a space within the centre of the site which could actually be public park. And what you can't see, but off to the left of this picture, is the Roman and medieval city wall, which was separated from this sort of effectively related church tower by the 60s development. So now there is a one-acre park in this very, very dense urban area of the city, and the developers and the site owners are now using it for all sorts of events and well-being activities and so on. So it's a really, really nice sort of example of good design, I think. Another city wall example, which is underway at the moment, is city walls are hugely important, as we will come on and hear in a minute, and the City of London, unfortunately, has lost much of its, most of its city wall. This was a section which was embedded between two properties, and the developer is actually developing both properties. This has enabled this section of the city wall to be exposed, and on the right-hand side of there, you may just be able to see there's going to be a case full of artefacts which will be on permanent loan from the Museum of London, and this will be a public sort of cafe space within the building, and it's really just elegant, nice piece of design, bringing a piece of city wall back to life. On to my last two micro examples. The theatre in Shoreditch. Shoreditch is northeast, just northeast of the City of London. In the 16th and 17th centuries, it was one of the key entertainment zones in London, and it is again now, interestingly. And it's where the first theatres were set up. And in fact, on this site, the first purpose-built theatre was built in 15-something, I can't remember, 1587, 15-something. By James Burbage, and it's where certainly Shakespeare's company would have performed plays, is where Romeo and Juliet was premiered. Unfortunately, over the years, most of the theatre has been lost, and in fact, there wasn't very much left of the superstructure, because in 1597, Burbage had a dispute with his landlord and dismantled this theatre, took it across the river to Southwark and built the Globe, which is where most of the Globe Theatre came from. But this is a residential development, and sort of effectively the bit above the image you have here is all going to be flats, but the developer has kept this space as a sort of micro museum piece of placemaking. And again, objects related to the theatre will be borrowed from the Museum of London, Victoria and Albert Museum, and then there's a sort of marking out in the floor of where the actual sort of foundations of the galleries would have been. And I quite like this example because they're putting in what's a sort of micro, it's what they call a vision panel, and it's a tiny hole which you'll be able to look through and see some of the actual very fragile archaeological remains, and it's almost sort of validating that this is actually the real archaeological site, and it's almost like a holy relic, I think, of Shakespeare's time. And now my final example of placemaking, which is the smallest, but I think it's one that illustrates the point of placemaking, which is it's about our emotional response to the evidence of our shared past and the stories that we tell about that past. And what it is, I don't know if any of you know, in the City of London there's a building called the Gherkin. It's one of the first of this sort of unusual shaped buildings. During the excavations for that building in the mid-90s, we found a sort of the isolated burial of a young Roman girl. It turned out she was probably about 13 or 14, not in a cemetery. And the developer of the site, who is the man you can see on the left, was so taken by this and actually really, really moved that he felt a sense of responsibility to the parents of this girl, and he felt that she shouldn't end up just in a box in our archives, but deserved a proper burial on the site. So he campaigned for 10, 11 years to have a reburial. Burials were forbidden in the City of London as part of the 1857 Burial Act, so that was quite an ask. But it happened, and now if you visit the Gherkin, there's a very small plaque in the ground and an appropriate Latin inscription in English to the spirits of the dead unknown Roman girl. It's a very quiet, unassuming, but I think a very powerful piece of placemaking. Thank you.